Friday night, after the easy victory over Louisiana Tech, Knight walked onto the floor at halftime of the second game to do a radio show. Three Big Ten officials were working that game. One of them was Tom Rucker. When Knight had finished the interview, he found himself seated 15 feet behind where the officials were standing, waiting for the second half to begin. "Hey, Rucker," Knight yelled, "have you figured out the difference between a block and a charge yet?" All three officials smiled at Knight's reference to the Kentucky game. "You think I'm kidding, don't you?" Knight continued, now standing and walking towards Rucker. "Why don't you do everybody a favor and just quit? You make everyone in the game look bad." The gym was almost empty, most of the fans having gone home after the Indiana game, and Knight's words seemed to echo. He was past Rucker now, but looked back to get in a few more swipes. "It's not funny, Rucker. The only thing funny about it is that you're a goddamn joke." Back in his locker room, Knight smiled. "I really nailed him. The last word, again." Knight and Rucker would meet again before the season was over. Knight knew that, but... Indiana annihilated Texas Tech in the final, breaking the game open after a sloppy first half that nonetheless produced a 9-point lead. But before the game could end, Knight's sense of honor got him into trouble. Knight had been unhappy with the officials throughout the tournament. They were Mid-American Conference officials, and he hadn't been pleased with them from the start. During most of the Texas Tech game, he practically begged for a technical foul. The officials, clearly intimidated, never gave him one. But with 4:06 left in the game, and Indiana leading 69-47, the officials gave one to poor Gerald Myers, the Texas Tech coach. Knight was distressed and embarrassed. Myers had not said or done half the things Knight had done, and now, trailing by 22 points, he was given a technical in Indiana's tournament. First, Knight ordered Alford, who had automatically gone up to shoot the technical fouls, to back off. Instead, he had Steve Isle, far and away Indiana's worst foul shooter, take the shots. He missed both. 1 minute later, Jadlow was called for a routine foul. Knight stormed onto the court, running to the opposite foul line, acting berserk. He was going to get a technical if it was the last thing he ever did. For his efforts, he received two technicals. The crowd hooted. To them, Knight was going berserk with a 20-point lead in a game that was already over. Knight was doing what he thought was right. He felt obligated to get a technical, and he knew that as long as he stayed in the coaching box, the area right in front of the bench, he wasn't going to get one. He had already called one official a chicken shit motherfucker and not received one. By charging onto the court, Knight gave the officials no choice. He had done this before in a similar situation. It was the right thing to do in his mind. He wanted everyone to know that the officials were awful. Knight also knew that most people would not see the incident this way. They would see it as another example of Knight going over the edge. In this case, they would be completely wrong. Knight knew just what he was doing. Even so, he hated behaving this way in front of Iba. When he walked into the coach's locker room after the game, Iba was waiting. "Coach, I just feel so bad about what happened," Knight began. "Don't say another word," Iba said, holding a hand up to break Knight. "I know what you were doing, Bob. You did just fine." Knight sighed and sat down heavily. When he is depressed about something, he looks about 100 years old. That was the way he looked now. "I really don't want these things to happen," he said, thinking out loud again. "I keep telling myself not to let them get to me, and then they do. I mean, it's our tournament, the game is over, and the gutless son of a bitch calls a technical on Gerald. It just isn't right." Knight was still bothered by the incident when he walked into the post-tournament party. All his buddies from Orville were there, along with the coaches from Indiana and the other three schools. This was an annual event. One person who had looked forward to the party was Murray Bartow, until he had mentioned to Knight how much his wife was looking forward to the party. That was when Bartow learned that his wife shouldn't be looking forward to the party, since no women need apply. Men only. "I'm taking her a doggy bag," Bartow said glumly, shoving some barbecued ribs onto a plate. Knight's sexism is no secret. In fact, he often wears it like a badge of honor. The women in his life have very defined roles. Nancy Knight has been a wife in the most traditional sense: mother, cook, housekeeper, fan of the husband's basketball team. Knight has two secretaries, whom he treats with great respect at all times, as secretaries. Buzz Kerpius, the academic counselor for the players, is someone Knight feels comfortable with and often tells jokes to. One day in practice, Knight used the word peace. "You know what a peace is, don't you, Buzz?" Knight said. "All women do." This was Knight's way of treating Kirpius as a near equal. But most women didn't merit such treatment. Knight was always polite to them, curbed his language around them, and had little use for them in a social setting. When he wanted to relax, he wanted to be around men. He didn't feel he could be himself with women around. Mike Krzyzewski, who had three daughters, often thought it would have been healthy for Knight to have had a daughter. His sons were not so sure. "I think if I had come out a girl, he would have shoved me back inside," Pat Knight often said. An exaggeration, maybe.